Ladies and gentlemen, please stand. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. We are gathered here today to honor the life of our beloved sister, Dawn Whitelock, a sister who we knew very well, whose life demonstrated that indeed she was a servant of God and a friend to humanity. This church, the Maranatha Church, was her home for many years. Her benevolent spirit, calm temperament, and faithfulness in service are among the many wonderful things that she will be remembered for. She is remembered for. We're not here because Dawn died. In fact, we're here because she lived. We are here to say thank you for the way that she touched and brightened our lives. We're also here to offer comfort to the family by our words and our presence. And finally, we are present here to hear what God has to say about the realities of life, the certainty of death, and the blessed hope of eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. At this time, we're going to begin by singing the hymn 5, the hymn, All the Way My Savior Leads Me. Please bow your heads as we pray. Heavenly Father, great God, God above all, we bow in your presence today with thanksgiving in our hearts, even while we grieve. We pray for the grace to balance the tension between grief and gratitude. Grief for the loss of a dear loved one, but gratitude because she was so dear and that you chose to bless us with her. We treasure the memories, but now, Lord, we pray especially that you would be in this place, that you'd comfort the family who grieve at this time. May they sense your presence near. And in the days, weeks, and months ahead, may they find you as a close companion on this journey through the valley of grief. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. From this point on, the program will flow unannounced, so we ask that you just pay attention, and when it's your turn, just move right here to the podium and speak. We will begin at this time with scripture reading by Rochelle Samuels.
Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hadst formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Thou turnest man to destruction and sayest, return, ye children of men. For 1,000 years in thy sight are but as yesterday when it is past, and as a watch in the night. Thou carriest them away as with a flood. They are as asleep in the morning. They are like grass which groweth up. In the morning it flourisheth and groweth up. In the evening it is cut down and withereth. For we are consumed by thine anger, and by thy wrath are we troubled. Thou hast set our iniquities before thee, our secret sins in the light of thy countenance. For all our days are passed away in thy wrath. We spend our years as a tale that is told. The days of our years are 70 years, and if by reason of strength they be 80 years, yet is their strength labor and sorrow, for it is soon cut off and we fly away. Who knoweth the power of thine anger? Even according to thy fear, so is thy wrath. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. This is the word of the Lord.
Amen. Sorry about that. I thought there was some other people ahead. Good afternoon, church. Church, friends, family, and well-wishers. Remembering Dawn. A woman of God, gentle, generous, caring, a loving spirit, with a quiet, friendly manner, self-sacrificing, and humble. My name is Flo Riley, formerly Nibs, an old friend of Dawn and her sisters. I've known Dawn most of our lives, first meeting her in Sabbath school at Camp Hill Seventh-day Adventist Church in Birmingham, England, when the Robertson family immigrated from Jamaica and began attending the church. Since Dawn and I were closest in age, we soon became fast friends. And for the rest of our childhood, into our teens and early 20s, growing up, going to AY, Pathfinders, summer camps in Wales, local camp trips, church trips, visiting other churches. We were choir members and in various singing groups. She was very active in church and enjoyed our Christian upbringing and experiences. She was a creative person. She was a Cradle Road teacher, an honorary auntie to many toddlers and children who loved her. Cooking, cake baking, and decorating were some of her skills. And I was quite envious of her sewing skills because she effortlessly was able to whip up a new outfit almost every other weekend, it seemed. I eventually left the UK for the US in the 70s, and gradually the Joyce and then Janet and her family, followed by their parents, who all finally settled in Florida. Eventually Dawn too arrived, and we rekindled our old friendship. I was a frequent visitor for weekends, Sabbath lunches, and many holiday gatherings, our friendship picking back up where it had left off. I was happy for her when she met Cyrus Whitelock, as she had been a single lady for quite a few years. And fortunately, he was at home when she had her tragic episode and was able to get her quickly to a medical facility. At first she rallied, and she was even able to give me a rundown of all that had transpired that day, but soon went downhill and never again was the same person that we knew. The fact that she endured for about 14 years is a testament to the care and concern of her family, husband, and friends, also the staff at the St. John's Nursing Facility. I miss her and feel sad to know she has passed, but I am aware that it was also a blessing. She can now rest and be at peace. I will remember the old times, the fun and adventures, the camaraderie and the friends we shared. So take your rest, my friend. You are missed. My sympathy, condolences to all the family members.
Afternoon, church. We're here from the Maranatha Children and Sabbath School Division for Children. Thank you. Dawn Whitelock served in the Sabbath School Lord Division as kindergarten teacher for many years. Dawn was the key that unlocked the young children's mind, and she was dedicated to the department. Every Saturday, she was there early, no matter what time it was. She was always there, ready and prepared for the children. Today we say our goodbyes. Today we say thank you and our goodbyes for her many dedication and hard work for the department and how she served at the Maranatha Church. Thank you. Until we meet again.
Hello, I'm Auntie Dawn's favorite niece. If everybody could be so kind and just get your phones and find your nearest silent and mute button, we would greatly appreciate that. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I'm a part of the extended Gibson Robinson clan, Whitlock clan as well. Just want to say that Auntie Dawn will be truly missed. Even though really didn't see her much after her her episode, I know that she was loved. She was cared for. And the song I'm going to sing, it's not a slow song, because Auntie Joyce requested something upbeat, something to, you know, remember her life, remember her memory. So all I'm going to say is, keep in mind, she's going up yonder. If you wanna know where I'm going, soon. If anybody asks you, where I'm going,
Hi, everyone. It's Ken Burtz, Christine Burtz. We just want to give some commiserations to the Robinson family, and especially to Dawn's husband and everyone who suffered the bereavement because of the death of Dawn. We're from Camp Hill, Birmingham Church, where Dawn grew up, and she had so many good times. We were all part of those good times in different ways. Personally, I was in Pathfinders when we started off many years, 1966, and Dawn was involved in Pathfinders then, and she's probably one of our counselors at the time. But later on, when we restarted Pathfinders in Birmingham at Camp Hill Church, Dawn played a major part in working with the adventurers and Pathfinders and doing the Master Guide course together. She was just brilliant, someone you could always depend on, someone who's always had a happy smile. If she was angry with you, she had real reason to be angry with you, but it never lasted long. She's a happy person. We missed her when she went to America. And when we had our 50th anniversary at Camp Hill, there's only one person I wanted to be part of that anniversary and to meet and greet everyone, and that was Dawn. But she'd already left and gone to America, so she wasn't able to be there at the time. But we miss you all, and we'll miss her especially. And we hope you have a good service remembering her. We'll be watching online, and we'll all remember Dawn and the good times that we had together with her and the blessing she was for all of us.
There are just three things that I'd like to say about Dawn. Number one, she was a virtuous woman. She was a godly woman, had a strong faith. Number two, she was the best Sabbath school leader for the children in our church. And even our daughter experienced Auntie Dawn. And she used to always come back to church in the afternoon and bring, she used to have a cool bag with lots of special goodies for the children, usually grapes. And everybody loved her, and all the children loved her. Our daughter's now 22 and still remembers those times growing up as a child. And number three, she was extremely capable. And one of those capabilities was reflected at Camp Hill Church as the church clerk. And, you know, she was so good and so efficient at what she did. And so to the family, we just want to send our love, and we send our condolences at this time. And especially on behalf of Camp Hill Seventh-day Adventist Church, we send our greetings to support you. And as Ken said, we'll all be watching. Take care. God bless.
What consists of weekend calls to check up on her trio, the fashionista, the keeper of all of our secrets? I told somebody bring her tissue. I told her we should have brought tissue.
I'm not crying.
I knew we should have brought tissue. Our secrets, the one who baked birthday cakes for us, vacationed with us, gave us wet kisses, and spoiled us like crazy. We stood beside Auntie Dawn at this same spot on her wedding day, and we stand here as a product of her love, prayers, hopes, and dreams for our success in life. And we have become quite successful. It was always important to us that Auntie Dawn never miss any of our achievements in life, although this whole process has been bittersweet. When I graduated from nursing school, Auntie Dawn's oldest niece, and probably her favorite, Marie, made sure we took a picture and placed it in Auntie Dawn's room in the nursing home, to show that one of her nieces were a nurse and one is a lawyer, so they know they didn't want any problems with us.
One thing I'll always remember about Auntie Dawn is that she was also one of the fastest drivers that I knew. I don't know, I never got to really see if she's faster than my mom, but she can get around London pretty fast in a stick shift. So when I met Sierra, and it was now my wife, of course, and became part of the family even before we became married, we got to visit Auntie Dawn in the nursing home. We got to place a picture in there of the wedding, in the wedding too. But of course, when our beautiful son Carter was born, you know, quickly we were able to have him meet Auntie Dawn too. I know what Auntie Dawn was thinking, that our Craig has grown up into this awesome family man and also her favorite and best nephew ever.
They chose to, you know, save the best for last. So, hi everyone. My name is Marie, Auntie Dawn's first and favorite niece. Okay. Auntie Dawn was not physically present for the birth of her grandniece Riley and her grandnephew Carter. However, we made sure they both knew who she was through photographs and joining us on visits to the nursing home. Carter has such a huge personality. When he comes into a room, he doesn't know you. He carefully checks you out. He's so introspective and so caring, all at the tender age of two. Riley is well known at the nursing home. She started visiting the nursing home when she was about 1 month old. From being in my arms, she graduated to pushing Auntie Dawn in the wheelchair, sitting outdoors in the garden under the covered pagoda, and having worship with Auntie Dawn and just chatting about all the things. We will make sure to cover, spoil, and love Riley and Carter just as Auntie Dawn would.
We will be their
soft place to land, just like Auntie Dawn was for us. Her legacy lives on.
We thank Auntie Dawn for bringing our family even closer and showing our family who our support team is. Mm-hmm. We couldn't ask for a better village.
Mm-hmm. We don't appreciate Auntie Dawn leaving us here with these two bossy Robinson sisters.
Marie said I didn't say it loud enough. We do not appreciate Auntie Dawn leaving us here with these two bossy Robinson sisters. For those who might not know, my name is Anthea Gibson. Joyce Gibson is my mother, and Craig and Marie Fox are Auntie Janet's children. That's what Uncle Basil told me to say. But not to worry. In the great getting up morning, we will all be reunited together in the second coming. Thank you.
Thank you.
I could say about Auntie Dawn, but I've been instructed by my big sisters, Marie and Anthea, to keep to time, so I'm going to be obedient. Growing up in Birmingham, Auntie Dawn was one of the most influential women in my early childhood. To some, she was their kindergarten Sabbath school teacher, but to me, she was a person that I wanted to become as an adult, single with an abundant life. I wanted to dress in stylish chic clothes with a matching bag, shoes and scarf just like her. Auntie Dawn had an abundance of clothes in every colour, much like her radiant, warm personality. During Sabbath lunch, she would let me play dress up in her room, trying on her floral scarves, her painted shoes and her array of sweet smelling perfume. I cannot forget the figured bottle of her Jean Paul Gaultier scent. She was selfless in nature, always loving us like her own. She made me feel special and always understood in every way. I was a picky eater, but Auntie Dawn would always provide 3 sausage rolls every Sabbath just for me. My mum called it spoilt, but I knew it as love. Auntie Dawn could throw down in the kitchen, much like all my other aunties. Her pie is a family favourite to this day, and luckily she taught my mum how to make the recipe so we can still enjoy it and think of her when we eat it. Auntie Dawn was the only other person Christopher Webber and I could sit with apart from our parents in church. She had the best children's books and activities, which we loved, and it allowed church to move a lot quicker. Auntie Dawn had the most organized car. Her car was full of grapes and snacks when we were hungry in the afternoon. And she also had her crates of Sabbath school resources ready and available at any time. As children, we were never without our physical, spiritual, or emotional needs being met by Auntie Dawn whenever she was around. I wish she would have been able to see all of us now. I feel that she would be so proud of all that we have become and accomplished. But we are encouraged that we all hold an element of her character within all of us. She held a rare, magical light that we continue to carry. When you see us step out, just know Auntie Dawn trained us. I look forward to the day when we can see her again in the earth made new, in a new perfect shell with her beautiful smile. Till then, Auntie Dawn, we love you abundantly.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. I'm the husband of one wife. Dawn Whitelock. And with here, my brother sitting at the front here, my son next to him. This is also one of my sister. And beside my son, there's another sister. And beside that sister is another sister.
And come.
I had also my granddaughter and grandson are here. I'm happy to have them with us. My nieces and my nephew also. We just want to give God thanks for everything.
Amen.
How did I meet Dawn? I give someone who was near to me a ride to the Maranatha Seventh-day Adventist Church. It so happened that the gentleman who I brought to church, you, Mr. Robinson, that's Dawn's father, from Jamaica. We were both invited to have lunch by the Robinson house that Sabbath.
While we were sitting at the dining table, I was noticing Dawn's every move. After lunch, I asked Dawn to step outside, as I had something to say to her. After talking to her for a while, I asked for her phone number, as I would like to stay in touch with her. She flatly said, "No, I will not give you my number." I still did not lose hope. I noticed Dawn would take her parents to church every Sabbath. Each Sabbath, she would have to lift her mom out of the car. One Sabbath, I went over to her and offered to help her with her mom. This went on for a couple of weeks. And on the third week, Dawn said, "Do you still need my number?" Come now, Van Rie. Van Rie, read now.
I gladly said yes. From that day, we would
communicate daily.
On April 1st, 2007, I was at church and took sick. I was unconscious. I went to the hospital and woke up at 3 o'clock in the morning. When I looked around, I saw Dawn sitting at the bedside. I asked if she just came. She said no. She has been there since the afternoon. I did not have health insurance at the time, and unknown to me, Dawn gave the hospital her insurance. So she gave her the insurance information to cover most of my bills, which came to over $30,000.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's the woman I married. And when she did that, I said to her that, if you marry me, I'll give my life for you. And that if she should go back for another 14 years, she would still be my wife.
Hey.
While in the hospital bed, I told Dawn I wanted to marry her and for her to be my wife forever. She said, "Cyrus, I want to be your wife." I was so excited to hear her, to hear that. And if it wasn't for the seriousness of my illness, I would have jumped out of the hospital bed and start to break dance.
Come on. You want me to read now?
So, are you listening? Yeah?
Yeah.
Yes.
On July 8, 2007, four months after my hospital stay, Dawn and I got married. My plan was for us to have a long, happy, and healthy life together. As fate would have it, that was not meant to be. On August 12, 2009, my wife took sick. Exactly 2 years, 1 month, and 4 days after we had married.
Dawn fell ill
with bleeding on her brain. Shortly after, Dawn was confined to a nursing home for almost 14 years.
During those 14 years, I would go everything for Dawn. I would visit her at least 3 times per week. And if it wasn't for COVID, I would be still there. And sometimes you don't have to believe me. Sometimes the nurse have to run me from the hospital, from the nursing home, because I wouldn't want to leave. Okay. On Sabbath, I would worship with her, even though she could not respond. Most Sabbath, I would spend at least 6 hours with her. On July 29, 2023, my wife had died. She was everything to me. I love her with a never-ending love.
Nothing or no one in this world could cause me to leave my wife. We had a happy 2 years, 1 month, and 4 days of marriage before she took ill. My only hope is that one day, Dawn and I will meet again when Jesus comes for his children. Until then, Dawn, I will always remember you and the times we shared together, the good, the bad, the happy, the sad, until Jesus comes, and even after, I will always love you. Sleep on, my beloved Cyrus.
As you have heard in the many testaments and reflections, Dawn was a lover of children. She, even though she did not have any of her own, she was dedicated to caring for them in an extraordinary way. The Maranatha Children's Department was blessed with her presence through the years that she's been here. And so it's only fitting that the offering today that we're collecting be for the Children's Department at the Maranatha Seventh-day Adventist Church. So as Dawn gave generously in her time and presence to the Children's Department, I'm asking you to dip in your pockets and your pocketbooks. No jingling the stuff, but give generously as Dawn would have you for the Maranatha Children's Department. Thank you and God bless. The deacons will now wait on us. Also mention for those online that you can pick up Maranatha Seventh-day Adventist Church and give online. Go on when you go under giving, online giving, you can pick up Children's Department and you can give your offering there. I'm sorry, I don't want to miss you out. I know you want to give too.
Sorry. Afternoon. My name is Kumar Whitelock. I'm the granddaughter of Cyrus and the daughter of Kimoy Whitelock. Okay. Oh, and that's my lovely mother. Hello. Oh, and my lovely father, so he doesn't say that I dance, call him lovely. Okay. I'm ready.
Been faithful, and all Good morning, everyone. My name is Herlene Simon, and this is my husband, Errol, and we've been friends of the Robinson family for quite some time. So we feel very privileged to have been asked to read this eulogy for our dear friend, Dawn.
Dawn Annette Robinson Whitlock was born Tuesday, July the 8th, 1952, in Hope Bay, Portland, Jamaica, to the late Louise and Matthew Robinson, the second of three children born to the union. Dawn was the quiet and calm soul in between two very talkative and boisterous sisters, Joyce and Janet. In December 1960, at the age of eight, Dawn, along with her sisters and their mother, emigrated to England to join her father. And Dawn attended Bordesley Green Girls School. Upon graduating, she attended Hall Green College, where she obtained her CSE diplomas, enabling her to secure a position as trainee pharmacy technician at East Birmingham, now Heartlands Hospital. Later on, she completed a BSc honours degree with the Open University. Dawn worked hard and was promoted to the position of senior pharmacy technician, a role that she fulfilled for over 40 years. She made many friends throughout her work history, many of whom often checked on her during her illness and remember her lovely personality. Indeed, Dawn had a heart of gold, fueled by her love for Jesus, and has been described by friends, including ourselves, as one of the most kind and generous and loving persons that we have ever met. Dawn was unique. She had a bubbly and fun-loving personality with a wide circle of friends. They recall with fondness the times they visited other churches where Dawn would be instantly recognized by many. At days of fellowship, you had to be prepared to leave much later than the others at the end, as she had so many people to greet. And Saturday night trips in her gold Datsun car to youth club at Oxford Street Church in Wolverhampton, with a stop at the dumpling shop in Handsworth on the way back, provided great social interaction for those new to the Birmingham area.
Dawn's home church in Birmingham, England, was Camp Hill, Seventh-day Adventist Church. In her youth, she was the secretary of the youth club called Koinonia, meaning Christian Fellowship. And their motto was, youth together for youth to gather. And she participated in various singing groups. She was an ever-present member of choirs and acting groups, such as the AY Singers and The Witness. Dawn supported many of the youth activities, including youth retreats. And she was very circumspect in her behavior. So when other counsellors, whose names I shan't mention, were engaged in pillar fights at Clanridnod Wells in Wales, for example, Dawn was not impressed. Dawn had a zeal and love for her Lord and was a faithful member of the church. Her dearest passion was for the children, and there's a generation of young adults who still call her Auntie Dawn. She faithfully and ably ran the kindergarten Sabbath school for many years, providing engaging activities for the children who came excitedly to participate in activities even before Sabbath school had started. Her room was always decorated to a high standard and in reality resembled an early years primary school classroom. Her display boards were changed at least once per quarter, and there were helpful reminders of the memory verses and themes to reinforce the children's learning and to encourage their spiritual development.
Dawn always kept a generous supply of goodies. That is, sweets and other delights for those not familiar with the term, in her car, along with excellent resources to occupy her niece and nephew and their friends during divine service. She was a faithful adventurer and pathfinder counselor, as well as an extremely competent and reliable church clerk for over 20 years. An interesting thing is that when friends visited Dawn in Florida, a couple of years after she had emigrated, she was found fulfilling the same role as kindergarten Sabbath school teacher and church clerk at Maranatha SDA Church. Even while in hospital after her aneurysm, Dawn sent messages to church to ensure that the children had the correct activities for her Sabbath school. She was truly an amazing person. Like other members of the Robinson family, Dawn used to good effect her gift of hospitality. Students and other visitors new to the area were always made to feel welcome at the Robinson home, even though space was limited. Mm-hmm. With her well-established skills, guests were treated to a variety of culinary delights, and she did not hesitate to share her recipes. These are still used regularly today and are requested by the children, now adults, who have grown up on her cooking. Who can forget the famous vegetarian flan and leeks pie? She was even thoughtful enough to provide alternatives for those children, including ours, who did not enjoy a particular type of food.
In Birmingham, Dawn always looked after senior members in the church as well as her own parents. Every Sabbath, she would attend to her parents, then pick up other senior members on the way to church, even though it would sometimes slow her down. Brother Robinson was her main challenge, as he would usually forget something inside and have to go back into the house to retrieve it. She would often say, with her well-known lisp, "I was ever so cross this morning," then went on to relate how he had caused her to be delayed. Being a very creative person, Dawn was always eager to learn new things and became very competent in a range of skills, including cooking, sewing, baking, cake making and decorating, floral arrangements, and gardening. Dawn loved to sew and made many of her Sabbath outfits. It looked as though she had so much money. Little did people know that she sewed them herself and that the material was economically priced. One of Dawn's favorite pastimes was shopping, especially for clothes. In fact, her email address was clothesgalore@hotmail.com. She loved a bargain, and as she didn't keep their whereabouts to herself, we all benefited from her razor-sharp antennae to locate shops with great sales. She taught us how to avoid exorbitant prices and, like herself, to look good without breaking the bank. Visits to Petticoat Lane Market in London and the main summer and New Year sales in C&A, Debenhams, Richards and Lewis's, just to name a few, were regular activities.
Dawn enjoyed travelling, which included trips to Canada, USA, Jamaica, Tunisia, and many places in England and Europe. Once family members, however, had settled in the USA, her trips were mainly to Florida. And she especially loved to see her nieces, Marie and Anthea, and nephew, Craig. Dawn also loved driving and was not afraid to put the pedal to the metal or floor it. And Basil, often during these times, sat in the back seat of the car. After many visits to the USA, Dawn, in 2004, decided to join her parents and siblings in Florida, who she missed very much. On coming to America, she resumed her work as a pharmacy technician, and then later worked as a customer service representative for PRC, where she found the pace quite challenging compared to her work in England. It was here in the USA at Maranatha SDA Church that Dawn met and later married Cyrus Whitlock on July the 8th, 2007.
In August 2009, Dawn awoke with a severe headache and was taken to Memorial Hospital, Pembroke, where she was diagnosed with a brain aneurysm. Dawn regained consciousness for a short while, but after multiple strokes, she suffered brain damage. Since then, she has been attended to by the dedicated staff at St. John's Nursing Home in Lauderdale Lakes, for whom we are forever grateful. After 14 peaceful years there, on the 9th of July 2023, Dawn passed away gently in her sleep. She leaves behind to mourn her passing her husband Cyrus, her sisters Joyce and Janet, brother Wentworth, and a host of family and friends.
We all look forward to the resurrection when we will see our Dawn again, with a bright smile on her face, and enjoy her company for eternity in the earth made new.
Why? Cheer up, my brother.
Amen. That is the hope of each one of us, that even though in the midst of the loss that we experience, the one day we will understand it, and it will be worth it all when we see Jesus. I want to express to the family, to Cyrus, to Joyce and Janet, to Wentworth, to Anthea, Craig, and Marie, and all the other family and friends who are here, sincere condolences on behalf of myself and our family. Andrea and Nathaniel and Hannah Mae would have been here today, but we have come to the point at which major transitions are taking place, and Hannah Mae is enrolled at Andrews with her brother now, and so mom is there ensuring that they settle in. Most parents only go for a few days, but she's been there for about a week. I don't know how long. So if you hear that she's moved up to Berrien Springs, believe it, I can tell you. But we have very fond memories of our time with Dawn and the family, and so I count it quite a privilege to be able to have this opportunity just to share a few words in reflection. As you will see in the order of service, it does say homily, and so you will not receive a sermon today, but just a few reflections. I too have been given instructions. But I want to say that on a day like this, it is always a time of very mixed emotions. There is, as has been expressed, the celebration of life, and yet there is the pain of loss. And we navigate those two realities in a service such as this, recognizing that there is not enough time to express the depth of feeling that we have as we reflect on Dawn's life and her legacy. But I would take an opportunity to draw our attention to a passage of scripture that is familiar to us, and that we may perhaps gain just some strength and encouragement. In fact, it's two verses. The first one is found in Ecclesiastes chapter 9 and verse 10, and it says simply, "Whatever thy hand finds to do, do it with all thy might. For there is no work, nor device, or knowledge, nor wisdom in the grave where you are going." And the second is Colossians 3 and verse 23. And it says, "And whatever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not unto man." Father, we thank you for this moment, and we ask that you, through the presence and power of your Holy Spirit, would speak to our hearts and give us words of encouragement, Lord, and comfort and challenge. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. I read once, and I'm sure you're familiar with the quotation, these words, "I've learned that people will forget what you said. People will forget what you did, but people will never forget how you made them feel." These words, if you understood and knew Dawn Robinson just a little bit, you would understand that she somehow managed to add to and surpass the profound words of Maya Angelou in this statement. Why? Because Dawn was simply unforgettable. In those three areas, unforgettable because what she said, her words were spoken with such consideration, such kindness and sympathy. Unforgettable because of what she did. Her extra large heart of generosity, her commitment to go the extra mile for anyone, and her service with a $1 million smile, just so impactful. And unforgettable because of the way that she made you feel. Appreciated, loved, valued, like you were the only person and the best person in the room. This was the Dawn that I knew. A case in point was the very first time I met Dawn. People think that my coming to America was the introduction to the family, but it really stems back even before meeting Janet and Joyce. Somewhere in the mid-90s, I visited Camp Hill Church, the church that was featured there in the special music and also where a number of the tributes emanated from. I was a young man then, with more hair and less weight. And I'd gone to listen to a speaker by the name of Adrian Roberts. He was a fiery young lay preacher at the time. And I went to the church. I traveled on the train and the bus, and I got to Camp Hill Church and enjoyed the service. And as I was leaving and went through the door, I heard a voice behind me. "Hello, young man, hello." I turned around. I didn't know then, but it was Dawn. She wanted to know where I was from and why I was leaving without having lunch. I said to her, I had to get back to Wolverhampton, and I was making my way to the train station. And for those who don't know, literally across the street from the church, there is a bus that takes you into the city of Birmingham, and you get your train from there. But Dawn insisted that she give me a ride to the train station. So it was that I sat in the car, and like many have expressed, I wondered what I had done. Because even though she had her modesty towel across her legs and put that car in first gear, she drove like a Formula One driver. I was wondering, did I miss something? Am I late for my train? And I remember asking her, "Dawn, what did you think of the sermon?" She said, "Well, at first I didn't know what to think because I didn't really like being told off. But then," she said, "as I listened more, I found it to be a blessing." As I exited the car, she said, "Next time you come to Camp Hill, remember, ask for Dawn, look for me, and you're going to come for lunch." It was many years, well, a few years actually, and I ended up being the associate pastor at Camp Hill Church in 99. And there was Dawn, full of energy, care, compassion, and interest. And indeed, of course, we had to go for lunch. Went back to school and came back to Camp Hill a few years later. And there was Dawn again, fulfilling all of those duties and responsibilities with passion and great desire. We became very close as a family, and in fact, Andrea was reminding me that during the first few years when Nathaniel was born, at first few months, Nathaniel got sick and Dawn came to visit at the hospital. And between Andrea and Dawn, they decided that they would clean the room to make sure there were no germs or anything that could be found. Such was her personality. And so in a very real sense, what has been said today expresses the person that she was. And yet we find ourselves in this moment with these mixed emotions. And those mixed emotions emanate from the fact that for the last 14 years, we have, to some degree, been robbed of the amazing person that Dawn Whitelock was. Cyrus only had 2 years of time to celebrate life with his wife. Sisters and family members weren't able to have those special moments celebrated in a way that Dawn would. And we ask ourselves, even in this moment, what can we gain from this sad end to an amazing life? And I believe there is something in this text that speaks to us very loudly, and it is simply as the Word of God says, that when we have time to do, we should do it with all our might. You see, the most powerful thing is that we have a legacy of someone who for the last 14 years was not able to do. And yet all of her industry and all of her commitment and all of her dedication speaks volumes that it has come across the Atlantic Ocean for people to testify of just what an amazing person Dawn Whitelock was. because she worked while it was day. She put her best foot forward. She did everything that she could as unto the Lord. And so even though she has not been able to add, she was not able to add in these last 14 years, she did so much in the time that she had that even now we speak of it and we remember it with fond memories. It challenges us today that we should do then what we can while we can. Many times in our lives we put off or we place in the future the possibilities of serving and blessing others, believing that there will be a season when it will be more easy or convenient for us. But Dawn's life speaks to the fact that not only should we do what we can while we can, but we also don't know when we won't be able to. We are reminded that the navigation of the lives in which we live is such that it brings pain in the midst of joy. Think about it for a moment, that this was the plan of the family, that everybody would be together, that they would do so many things together, like because they were all on the same side of the Atlantic. And yet, in just a few years, the whole hopes and dreams were changed, shattered, disrupted. Which reminds us, Christian friends and those who are watching online, that life is uncertain. We make plans, we have dreams, and we should have those things. But Dawn's life tells us that while we make plans, we must also ensure that we factor God as a priority in our life. Because so much of what was hoped for was not realized. So much of what was dreamt of was not seen. And so much of what was not anticipated became a reality. But today I want to say this. In every experience in life, God has a lesson for us. I think of you, Cyrus. I think of the commitment and covenant that you made, for better, for worse, in sickness and in health. And sometimes we make commitments in life, we say those words, but then the reality is very different. We celebrate you today that you stayed true to that. Amidst the difficulties that you faced, you stayed true to that. I celebrate the family who visited every Tuesday and Monday, who kept your appointment. And even though there was very little that you could get back, you stayed consistent to that. Many of you here supported them as a church, family, and friends, knowing that in the midst of those visits, it was always a mixture of joy and pain. Joy because you were able to see your sister, but pain because of what was lost and the reality of her decline. But you stayed faithful as not only sisters, but as a generation, and taught something very profound to your children, to your grandchildren, that we do what we do and we love the way we should, not because it is easy, but because it is what is required of us. And family means that we do the very best we can even when it hurts, even when we don't understand, even when life does not make sense. And so we celebrate you today. Janet and Joyce, we have spoken often about the questions in your mind, and I thought how fitting it was that we had that song, Father Along, because we know sometimes we don't get the answers to the questions that we have. It makes no sense to us that one who had so much love for people and who was so willing to serve God would be struck down, while, as the song says, there are others living around us, living so wicked year after year. But you see, the hand of faith was the hand that Dawn held. The hand of faith was the hand that you held as family and friends. And even though it did not make sense, you continue to love and to support and to care until the very end. There is, I believe, only two things that matter most when you close your eyes. And that is that you know that you are loved by God, that you, of course, have given love, and that there are others who love you. We know that that day when Dawn closed her eyes, she knew that she was loved by God. She knew that she had given love, and she also knew that she was loved by you all as family and friends. And so then, what as we face the future with the reality of her passing and these 14 recent years and the memories of the years that have passed? Her life speaks to us in volumes, that each one of us has been blessed with an opportunity to bless others. Each one of us has been blessed with an opportunity to navigate through the pain and disappointments of life to bring hope to somebody else. And each one of us has the opportunity to seek the Lord while he may be found and to call on him while he is near. You see, the power of Dawn's story is not simply how she served in the church and how many children she blessed and how faithful she was. It is not only that she had a loving family, a loving husband, and people who cared about her and saw value in taking care of her even when she could not help herself. But the power is that as ministers of the gospel, we stand here assured that her life was hid in Christ. And so in this moment, while we face the sadness of her passing, we have the joy that that passing was in the life that was tied up, tangled up, and wrapped up in Jesus. And this is the hope that burns within our hearts. Hope that one day we will see Dawn again. One day, indeed, the new morning will come. One day, that new getting up resurrection morning will be. New body. Same wonderful smile, but never to part again. And so we challenge us today, as we reflect on a life that was well lived and a life that reminds us of the tensions that we face in life, that we continue to press forward, knowing that God understands the frustrations and the disappointments of our hearts. But he did not promise us that the road would be easy. But we don't believe he has brought us this far to leave us. And so I encourage us today to keep this hope in your hearts. Keep the memory and example of the faithfulness of Dawn Robinson Whitelock with you, so that when the bumps in the road come, when the pains of our hearts are great, that we can know that there are others who have fought the good fight, finished the course, kept the faith. And because of that, a crown of righteousness is laid up, but not only for her, but for all those who love God and look for his glorious appearing. May God help us and bless us as we think on these things. Amen.
We're going to invite the congregation to stand as the family remains seated, and we will be praying for them at this time. While the family remains seated, all others please stand. Bow your heads with me. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for the life and legacy of our dear sister Dawn Whitelock, a wife, a sister, an aunt, a daughter, and a beloved friend to so many of us. You gave her to us for 71 years, and during these years, she brightened our lives, as evidenced by the various testimonies and reflections that have been given. She also served you faithfully at church, at home, at work. And Father, though the last 14 years have been difficult, and now she is no more with us, our assurance today is that her life is hid in Christ's, and that on that great getting up morning, we will meet her again. We lift up her family to you. We pray for her husband, Cyrus. Only you fully know and understand his love and devotion for his wife. And now only you fully understand the pain he feels at her loss. Comfort him, we pray. And may he be assured that just as he was there for her during the 14 years of her illness, you will be there for him during this difficult time. We pray for her sisters Joyce and Janet and her brother Wentworth and their spouses. No one, God, will be able to fill the void in their lives that comes from the loss of their sister. And so I beg of you now to embrace them in your arms of love. And when the memories of their sister's life flood their hearts and minds, and the tears may possibly begin to flow, remind them that tears are a language that you understand. And then, God, we pray for Craig, for Marie, for Anthea, for Sasha Louise, and all the other family members. They testified of how precious they were to their aunt. Please grant them the confidence that just as how they were precious to her, they are precious to you. And you will keep them even now. As we leave the family in your care, we do so with the belief that even in this moment of grief, your goodness is running after them. That goodness that runs after them, O God, will be fully realized when Jesus comes again. And so we pronounce your blessing upon them and ask, Lord, that you will bless them and keep them. Cause your face to shine upon them and give them your peace now and forevermore. We pray in Christ's holy name. Let everybody say.
Please remain standing. At this time, the family members could also stand with us as we sing the closing hymn, Sing the Wondrous Love of Jesus.
What a day of
rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We will sing and shout the victory while we walk the pilgrim's path with us. When we'll get to heaven, day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting. What a glimpse of Him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, sing and shout.
This is the desire of our hearts, that one day we will see you face to face, and all the troubles and trials of this earth will disappear. Until then, Lord, keep us faithful to you. And now we declare, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and grant you peace. Peace in your heart. Peace in your home. Peace in grief and loss. Peace until Jesus comes to take us to our eternal home. In his name be majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forevermore. Let everyone say amen and amen. Thank you so much. Please be seated. At the moment, we have our funeral director to come and give us instructions, and then we will follow those instructions and exit at the appropriate time. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, this does conclude our celebration of life for Ms. Dawn. At this moment, on behalf of the family, myself, and Fred Hunter, I want to thank each and every one of you for being here today with this beautiful family. Your presence, your calls, the flowers, beautiful. We want to thank you for being here. You could have been anywhere, but the fact that you are here with them means a lot. It will definitely alleviate their grief. Now, the family has asked that they do have a meal prepared, and they do want to break bread with you all. I believe the location is here, that they would like to have every one of you here with them in celebration of Dawn for a meal after the service. For those of you that are not going to accompany the family to the cemetery for Ms. Dawn's final resting place, after I have escorted everybody out, you may do so. I believe it is here. But we do have escort for those of you that are going to accompany the family to the cemetery. We do have escort that will be safely guiding us to the cemetery. For those of you who will be attending, with the family, please, once you get into your vehicle, turn your high beam lights on, indicating you are in the procession with us, and wait for the escort to guide us and follow closely so that we all can be together safely. Now, the address for the cemetery is in the back of your program. If you did not receive a program, I'm going to go ahead and repeat the address for you. That is Fred Hunter Hollywood Memorial Garden North, between Sheridan and Sterling. That is 3001 North 72nd Avenue in Hollywood, Florida. If you are following closely, you will be fine. If not, you have the address in the back of the program. I do have some pallbearers that are listed in the back of the program. So once you hear your name call, I'm going to need you to meet me at the first two pews in the front. I apologize if I mispronounced your name incorrectly ahead of time. Okay. Okay. Hold on. Let me put my glasses on. 1 second. I need my eyes. Yes, Kamei. Come on. See, I'm already starting. Kamor. Okay. Whitelock. Edward Gibson. Lawrence Whitelock. Greg Fox, Navon Wallace, and Calvin Brooks. I'm going to need three on each side. And I'm going to bring the casket in the middle. Clergy, you have something?
Everybody drive me crazy. Okay. Just a quick thing for those who are viewing with us online. And for people who may not be staying with us to the cemetery, you can view it online, the cemetery portion at iriefamilyservice.com. That is iriefamilyservice.com. Iri is I-R-I-E, familyservice.com. Y'all better now? I know. Thank you.
Okay. We will be exiting from the front to the back. So please, just follow as the roads, each road go by, and not ahead of time, because the procession would be the clergy, myself, the casket, the family, and so forth, each road. Clear? Okay. Well, I don't think I have to give the address for the repast, because we all are here. It is here. So, again, on behalf of Fred Hunter and myself, I want to thank every single one of you here for being with this beautiful family. My condolences to every single one of you, because we are grief. Thank you so much.